Our beloved campus. So if this campus has been here, not quite as long as Doug, no. Since 1933, we started as a normal school to prepare teachers, and over time we grew and evolved. At that early point, we were part of UW-Madison. And our courses were taught by extension instructors, which is why I think people still refer to us today as the extension, or other derivations of that. Then we became part of the UW centers, and then we became part of the UW colleges, the 13 two-year campuses of the UW system. Now we are a branch of UW-Stevens Point. So this is our fourth form. And I think it's why we're actually really rather used to change. Change for us is a constant. But the other constant is our love of teaching and learning. We're here, this campus is here, as it was in 1933, for teaching. Because we are, truthfully, all about students. And I think our students can attest to that. It's who we are as individuals, it's who we are collectively, and that is our legacy. It lives in our students who start here to pursue their dreams. Sometimes, as you're going to hear from our speakers tonight, they don't know yet what those dreams are. We help them to discover their dreams, and then to begin, at least, to fulfill them. And they come here from all over. Students, where'd you come here from? Wausau? Some? Merrill? Where else? Taya? Edgar? Where else? Wittenberg? Elena? Where else?
Park Falls.
Park Falls! Anybody further north? Wapaka?
Wanakee.
Marathon, right? So you come from all over. Idea, where are you from?
Woodbury,
right? You might be the furthest west. So you come from all over, from near and far, and when you get here, you work to discover, and it's work, you work to discover your dreams. And you also work, I think, to discover yourselves. That I've been able to be a part of this now for 21 years is amazing to me. And that Doug's been here even that much longer being a part of this is really amazing. But we are quite fortunate in that regard, that we get to be a part of watching you discover your dreams and discover who you are. And now our students move on with an associate's degree, an associate's degree that still is a stand-in for general education requirements wherever they go in the UW system. Some are transitioning to the main campus in Stevens Point. How many of you are doing that? Okay. Some are transitioning to UW-Madison. Who's doing that? Madison's in the group. Maybe Shannon? Ian? That's right. Ian's still in the wings. UW-Eau Claire? How many of you are headed to Eau Claire? And lots of other places, right? La Crosse, Green Bay, and elsewhere. For others, the degree is a way station as they pause their university education before they jump back in again later on. Perhaps back to this campus, because you know you might have heard that we'll be offering bachelor's degrees on campus next year, starting in the fall, in business administration and in social work. No matter the path, or the destination, all of these students have taken advantage of what we provide here. Small but challenging classes, faculty and staff who push them to grow, who care about their learning and care about them as individuals. That is, I think, and always will be, our hallmark. That is our legacy. And it's something to celebrate tonight. So tonight, I say again, we celebrate these amazing students. And we we celebrate this campus's amazing good fortune to have been part of their journey. And this is why, after tonight's ceremony, I will raise a glass full of ice cream to you, our students, and to us.
Talented vocal ensemble and led by Dr. Tim Buchholz. I don't know anything about Tim Buchholz, but he is fantastic. He does an amazing amount. I've been through several people, I've worn them out in the choir. He's been the silly rhythm in the concert choir, and it's good as the vocal jazz and sweet time. So don't worry about it. But he's amazingly talented and amazingly active. And he's done tons of stuff for the campus and for the community. So I hope you'll welcome now the vocal jazz ensemble with Dr. Tim Buchholz.
Thank you. Thank you.
if I should read some, I happen to know them personally. We know each other. It was a student of mine. I don't know. This is John Greenier, and he's actually was really active in the campus. This is back in 1999, 2001, around there. And was vice president of the student government. Was involved, did all kinds of things. But interested me, and I'm kind of transcending. He's also he and his lovely wife, and his lovely mother-in-law, his mother-in-law. And I've actually appeared in my classes talking about Native American things and bringing real experience to that, and a real focus, unlike some candidates for Senate who claim to be American Indian. So he's done enormously well. He's not a student, but he's a member of the Ho-Chunk Nation. And he was president of the Ho-Chunk Nation. He was assistant to the president before that, which would be like, oh my God, he's just about done everything. Now he says one of the, what is that? You're now a member of the board. And for cultural preservation. And? Oh, geez. He's wrong. He's going to correct everything I said. I mean, we've already talked about this, so it's all good. Anyhow, what I want to read here is something that I found really. But what I was supposed to read was that we put our collective heads together. Well, I wasn't part of the collective. Asking ourselves, who embodies this campus, what it means to us, to our students, and our community? Who would help us tell our story and celebrate our students and our campus? And the answer is a resounding John Greenier. So I hope you're welcome, John Greenier.
So that's a blessing for me to be here today and share a little bit with you today. How are you guys doing?
Good.
That was a nice little jazzy, unexpected interlude that I did. So I was like, Alex, putting some stuff on my Instagram, you can get that already, so I'm not going to tag you because I got your backs. But I was like, really amazed by the vocalization there. So in that, once that thing, let me go off of the cancer a little bit. Tonight, you know, going back to this indigenous history that, you know, and if you didn't want to hear any stuff, you wouldn't hire anything, you'd come up here and speak to them. But I am a preservationist. I am someone who works with a lot of history. Not history like when the first white guy cuts the land. I mean, I'm talking about the history that goes on before that. And tonight, across the region here, I don't like to say state because that creates borders and lines. The wind doesn't do that, everyone's going to do that, water doesn't do that, but we shouldn't do it. But anyway, around the area region of our several traditional Ho-Chunk groups that are singing tonight, in the midst of a ceremony that's going on. As a matter of fact, even hundreds of years ago, you could sit in this very spot here and hear the Veninga singing the songs because the surgeon are responding and they had ceremonies going on. A lot of these ceremonies moved over to the night because they were done in secrecy, because if you actually did them during the day when people could see you, they accused you of witchcraft and you suffered consequences. So a lot of the culture in terms of the actual traditional practices have changed. You guys learning things here in college, right? So some of the stuff that I will share with you, you're not going to find in history books, you're not even going to find in a Google search engine, because a lot of this is history from a different perspective. It is from that oral tradition, it's from people that aren't amazingly fascinated with things that sound well, their interest, but more appropriately, things that they have heard. As a matter of fact, a lot of the history that is here might be linguistical, might be social structure, might be archaeological history through Marathon County, through Cornish County, and all the way through Wood County. There were over 1,200 burial mounds on both sides of the river here. This was a big river. As a matter of fact, there were several over here in the city. So, obviously, those aren't here, but the history still lies here. The story still lies here. The names, the words still lie here. So I just want to give some recognition or that acknowledgement here to those who were here before us, but way before me, but as a legacy, as a person who comes from those descendants, and who's actually very proud nowadays to admit that we didn't have that opportunity even, 20 years ago when I was in school here. We had something new that was a new phenomenon. We had a rising Hmong population here, and we had people that were celebrating diversity, but had also had critical mass in terms of what we had to be able to we had to do a lot of learning. Keep in mind that the summer that I walked the stage was just months before 9/11, and the whole entire world changed, forcing us to learn a little bit more about cultures, about countries, about things that we may not have learned. It changed how professors teach it. It changed how we learn. It changed how we take care of ourselves in our home, how we have folks teaching about different cultures. So this was a part of our growing pains as a university, as a family, and as learned a little bit about how we conduct ourselves and how change happens. Even walking around physically, I can recognize a lot of things. But structurally, I have no idea what this merger is. How it works. And all I know is that there's a bunch of people that have the privilege of calling themselves the professors and administrators here that are doing their best to make that transition as seamless as possible to make sure that you are guaranteed the education that you've sought. And that is amazing. We all have a story of how we got here. Some of us, may have struggled or are already in a massive amount of debt. I don't think any of our parents were on full house. Our way into here and got into here. But whatever it took to get to this point, there had to be some struggle involved. And this was something I just recently read in the latest book from, what's the name? I forget his name, Mark something or other. Anyway, it's the subtle art of not giving up. And so a lot of folks have read it. He says that was amazing to me. Because you ever see people who are very successful, who have gone to the top of the ladder, whether it's economically, financially, or with their health, you'll notice that they embrace the struggle. Like that buddy who loves to go to the gym. I can't get motivated to go out there, and they just love it. They eat, and they go back to the gym. you got that person that works feverishly, 50 hours is nothing. That's like annual leave for them, but they're constantly working and they're at the top of the game. And the things that we find probably the most difficult to do is our struggle, but they embrace that. You know, I look at teachers the same way, teachers and professors who I think they're in a constant struggle. I have no idea why they do it. I have no idea how much they can cram into the world to do what they do to come up. And it took me a long time to actually see that reward that they get from what they do. When you learn something new, when you see something, when you question something, even those controversial issues that land in that class, when they think that, you know, that you finally learn something, you learn that you can challenge every one of these people up here. And every part of the system, you can challenge the machine. And when you learn that, you become empowered. And this is a really good portion of a skill to have, no matter what you're going to do in life. I remember when I first started, it was around 2001 or something like that. Doug was only 84. But I remember when I first came here, and how I got here, it was, you know, I don't tell the story too often. I think the last time I told it was here, like, a few years ago. But I really wanted to go to college, right? My twin sister and all, my younger sister was going. Everybody was going. And not only were they going to college, but they talked different. They talked smart. They used big words. And I was a musician, so I played. That's why I appreciated the music here in the harmonies. But I wanted to go, too. And I already had it in my mind that I was going to be a game warden in the state of Wisconsin. I was going to go into one of the best schools in natural resource management. I was going to graduate with a wildlife degree, and I'm going to go out, and I'm going to go carry a gun, and I'm going to drive around and look cool and talk to people that are hunting. That never happened, obviously. We're probably not destined, you know, in our minds, you know, the same way the way the circumstances lie out. But I applied to Stevens Point, my alma mater as well, and I was not accepted. Now, I was 29 years old, I had a 5-year-old child, and there was a lot of issues, like financial issues. I was a little overweight, would you say? Yes, you gotta be nice, aren't you? I was about 271 pounds when I first moved over to Wausau. But I applied and I was not accepted. And I called many times because at that time, there was about the time when we had an era of affirmative action. And campuses had changed things to how we began in 1998 of the plan in 2008, where we were going to increase the student of color body and the faculty and staff of color. And we were going to go out and recruit in these areas and start applying some areas so that we could start affecting some of the more disadvantaged communities. So I thought I had this on my side. So for those of you who feel like affirmative action was an unfair shake, I didn't get it. So I will argue with you and I will win. But we can still have coffee afterwards because I am a politician. We can do that. But at that time, I really felt like I had some sort of assistance. I didn't. And at that time, my daughter, who had was with me the whole way through this healing. I had quit drinking 21 years ago before I come here. Imagine quitting drinking and then becoming college students. Anyway. So I had things mixed up a little bit, but nonetheless, I came here. She actually joined. All of my professors that were here know my daughter. She was 5 years old. She was selling Girl Scout cookies, and she was going to my class and taking notes on John C. Calhoun, and she had actually been a degree actually from here. But she was with me because I didn't have any child care, and not a lot of money. But UWMC accepted me, and that meant a lot to me because I finally got to answer her question that she dogged on for days and days. Are you a college student yet, Dad? And it was just amazing because I wanted to say yes. I wanted to say it for myself. I wanted to. And it wasn't until I applied for UW-Maryland County that I heard that yes. And to this day, of those grand moments in someone's life, was me telling her that I'm a student. So we moved, we didn't have much. We looked like the Joes going down 29 from Green Bay, and we landed here at Stevens Point. And I remember standing right in front of the doors here, taking that golf and looking around. And like your goals, you know, like the kids. I'm 29. I've got a kid. I've got bills. I've got responsibilities. I've got a rap team. You know, I'm going to come in, and you know, I have no idea what I'm doing, and I was welcomed. I was welcomed by the staff here. People came out like the late, unfortunately, but the great Nolan was that we always had this weird thing to say, you know, like second orientation, and he said, everyone look at the person to your left, and look at the person to your right. One of you three will be an academic probation at the end of this visit. Come in, sir! I was really offended. So guess what? I worked hard. I studied every night. I made sure I prioritized that. I did what I could. I was driven. So after I got off of probation the first semester, I really knew that my lifestyle was completely different from that of a college student. I had to make some greater changes. And the challenges were already there because I would walk into a class. I couldn't fit into a lot of the desks, and some of the professors know that they had to make accommodations for me. I had to bring my daughter to class. And pretty soon, it got to a point where I was just not ready to consider dropping out. My grades weren't doing very well. My financial situation didn't improve at all. And folks from this amazing group called Trio put me back on the road academically. And then there was this little grant that came out, $200 a month. $200 a month today. You know what I do with it? I don't even know what I do with $200. That's like nothing these days. That's like ice cream, and you get to look at your coffee and stuff like that. You'll work it. But that meant the world to me. That meant that I could walk that stage somewhere along. And so, to this day, no matter where I go, no matter what I do, I always remember how much that little piece of thing meant to me. And what it could mean to someone else down the road. So I don't overlook that. And I remember that this very thing, when I walked in my first day as the president of the Ho-Chunk Nation, overseeing 3,400 employees, 8,000 tribal members, the first words out of my mouth is, our job is to take care of everyone at the back of the line. They may not have money, they may be felons, they may be single parents, they may be struggling college students, but this is our priority. If they are not your priority, I'll try to be in a different position, but our job in public service is to focus on those folks first. And so, this is what we built our administration on, and these are skills that I've learned here. So far, not much in the classroom, but just in life, working with human beings with hearts. After I had become more oriented with being a student, I became active with student government, and I did challenge the administration. It's actually kind of fun to see they jump, like, you know, meetings and stuff like that. But we had some good, you know, solid discussions about certain things, and I learned something. You know, one day, I sat with Professor Vaughn in his class. Now, I've been Native American for a pretty long time. I can't remember a time when I wasn't. But I watched this video, he showed this video. It was just absolutely eye-opening for me. What they were doing in the early 50s is they were shipping prefab homes out into Alaska. Because what they wanted to do was take this nomadic migrating tribe, the Civic, who ran the upper part of Alaska and northern Canada, and we called that home the vast white wasteland, as we would consider the tundras, and relocate them and get them solidified in a certain area so that no longer could they claim Aboriginal history to that land on the northern portion. They did that as well in South America, which he's very familiar with in terms of gaining resources, or epic rulings that say, yes, you own the land, but you don't own the minerals under them. And so, as I was going to school, I was getting pissed off. I was getting angry. Because you know what? We weren't winning these wars. We weren't showing up. We did not have a seat at the table. And so you look for causation. Why not? Where are our leaders? We're making great speeches, but we're not really coming out on top of anything. We need school. We need education. We need attorneys. We need marketers. We need folks in communication. And we need it for the, I'm sorry to say this, the struggling tribes out there. I'm one of 9%. I'm 9% in this 9% that holds a bachelor's degree. Only about 17% of our people leave high school and go on to college. I'm like the 65% in this room. We have a long way to go. But for those who have, they are embracing the struggle. They are seeing the challenges in front of them, just like each one of you will, because it's not going to be easy. This is just the start. And I'm not going to do the drill sergeant one, because you know what? You're going to make decisions in your life that are always going to be learning experiences. I remember listening to boring people up on the stages here give me all this advice on life, and you're just trying to keep your eyes open. And, you know, for the most part, the only thing I want you to leave with is to embrace the struggle. I spent a lot of time, after I found out that I was not game warden material. you know what? At that time, there were 72 game wardens in the state of Wisconsin, one for each county. I was sitting in a class with 300 kids with beers that all wanted to be game wardens. So I decided to leave that challenge off to the side, and I started actually getting into political science, really Western theory, John Pass. I had professors that actually turned their English into understandable English for me. And it was amazing because what I saw in what they wrote, I was learning history, so I wouldn't repeat it because there were some things that we did hundreds of years ago that we're doing today, and I can't believe people don't know. And so I started doing a lot of work in this area, and eventually I was appointed to work for the president of the Wausau Nation, which was really big because I didn't even know I was going to get a job. He just called me over there and read some of my papers to me that I wrote. And then next thing you know, he appointed me, and I didn't know I was going to be, you know, overseeing the operations. What I also didn't know was that job description came up, and it was like over $50,000 annual pay. Now, I don't know what that means today, but when you're a college student just barely making, learning for that $200 a month childcare stipend, and you see a real career come in front of you, it changed the world for us. But the most important thing, it wasn't what I was doing or who I was going to be working for or when I was thinking. I could not leave the thought of why I was there doing what we were doing. The things that our professors gave me helped me find homes for people who had just had a fight. They helped me find programs. They helped me link veterans up with services that they were completely qualified for. They helped me give keys to the child of a single mom to their new home. They helped me do everything like that. They helped me stand in front of Pat Buchanan, Mr. Anti-Immigration, and ask questions like, so, I'm a member of the Indigenous Aboriginal people here. When do you have illegal immigration begin? And watch your results. That was the confidence that I was guaranteed when I took up. It's supposed to make you uneasy. It's supposed to make you uncomfortable. That's what struggle is. It's supposed to be a beautiful thing that you learn from. And for all of you who are going on to another school, you have another struggle in front of you. And I'm really glad to hear that, because we need more of you. Our world needs thinkers. Our world needs artists. Our world needs kind people. Not good people, once in a while, not smiling and waving, kind people that through and through that are thinking about those ones that need help. That's who we need you for. So, when this was done, I was also struggling health-wise, and I wanted to make sure that my home was the last generation of diabetes when over 60% of our people are going to end up with type 2 diabetes. I wanted my home to be the last. So we began exercising, and I wanted to make sure that we did it without cost. I never wanted to go over and say to someone, I took this drink, I went to the doctor, or I went to the gym. No memberships, and we probably lost over 200 pounds in our family, and we continue to work out and make that a part of our lifestyle. We've also moved over to traditional diets, the gathering, foraging, getting things away from the store. Michael Pollan once wrote, in observation. It's amazing how revolutionary, but simple observation, something obvious is. He said that we no longer look for brand names in the store. We look for calcium rich and omega 3 and all these items, you know, fortified with vitamins and minerals. And we have become, as he labels us, the nutritionist society. Then he poses this question, which really stumped me. Are we more healthier now? Because of all this wonderful food, all these advances in science? No, we're not. It's just you want to eat a steak, eat a damn steak. You want to eat a potato? Throw it on there. But don't work out. Eat food. Eat deep dependence food. And so this amazing work that he did brought me back to the obvious is where we need to go. Now, I was really happy after I had graduated and worked again. Eventually, I had learned the language of our people, frankly, because my own people rejected me coming back as a college student. See, you have privilege. I don't care what color you are. I don't care how many kids you have. I don't care how old you are. If you're here in a role that we have, you've never gone public, you have privilege. I have privilege. I can't stand beside someone from our mission and say we're the same and our struggles are the same. I have a college degree. I have a couple of them. I'm proud of them. I can do a lot more because of that. I have my health. I can put my pants and shirt on all by myself. I don't have to worry about needing help to do that. That's privilege. And if you don't recognize you have it, that's what society failed. And we can do so much recognizing the privilege that we have and making sure that that thought is in with whoever we come by. So they had decided to send me a bunch of messages to run for the Wausau Nation president. Now, it's not a glamorous job, because I think the title kind of moves you away, gives you this idea that this is this omnipotent person. It's not. As a matter of fact, since 1963, only two presidents have made a full term in the Wausau Nation. Only two. Still have left on their own accord, but most of them are removed in the annual meeting. If you know you don't do well, you have got to bust gas to give us a minus as a president of the culture. The standards are high, the expectations are high, the resources are low, the rhetoric is indefensible, you just can't do it. So in order to be successful there, you actually have to do what you want to do first before you say it. So this means you have to work. This means that you have to put in tireless hours and you have to make sure that the people are always high level. Seeing our people, we have socialized to be shoulder to shoulder, eye to eye. Even our chiefs never stood above anyone. Our men never stood above anyone. Our community leaders never stood anyone. Our veterans never stood anyone. When the government came to force the models of governance on tribes, they gave you presidents. Chairman, they gave you governors, and they gave you this unitary structure, that triangle pyramid that we are always trying to climb that work. And I was trying to tell you that doesn't work. And this is why we're often taking the top off. So, in order to stay on top, ironically, you have to stay below. You have to stay with your people. You have to walk with them. You have to help them dig graves. You have to be there in the hardest times that they can ever endure. Because who do you remember the most? Your fair weather friends, or the people that say, hey, I hear you're moving on Saturday. I'll be over there with a the band. I don't have any friends like that, Heather. But if you do, those are probably your best friends ever. Think, you know what? Why don't you and your boyfriend go out for tonight, and I'll watch the kids for you. Go do something fun. Those are the things that you tend to appreciate. Those are the things that come from kind people. And that's what we're making here. The degree? It's just as good as the land out there. It's not going anywhere. You got it. You know, it's what you do with it. It's how you conduct yourself. And when you do well, when you're kind, the school remembers. They'll call you back. And they'll ask you to pass that message on. So when I became elected, I just took a Supreme Court to realize that I'm standing in the spot that I've always read about. See, I only read about my tribe. I never really got the chance to meet with my people. I just read about these heroes. These are my tribe. They're still there, like dinosaurs, you know. but they're amazing. They're bigger than me. They're still bigger than me. They've done amazing things. They've handled situations so much better than I could ever imagine. Because the problems that we have today are, they're like real problems, and they were there for them. They paved the way. You know, in Wausau, let's say, they were one of the product people who just watching. That's the idea of like, taking at the Wausau. We keep watching, we're not judging now. We're only going to take this far. We look at the timeline, let's go back to the ice ages. On a 50-foot stand, you represent a boat. Christopher Columbus was there about 2 feet of that. You're only a flip, so you're only going to be able to take things so far. And then, when you get around my age, you start thinking everything you do is for children. And this is the mentality that age brings you. And so, my hope here today in sharing with you is that why you're doing what you're doing, that there are people out there that need help. Innovations that need to be made. We need to create a peaceful society, a learning environment. You're the future of us, and we want to make sure that whatever it is we leave, Oja, King, Kajit, Peggy, Toy, Eggy, Lakum, 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 so whatever that is good that we have, we lay here before you. In this great moment that I had, opportunity to serve my people. The University of Stevens Point, called me up and they said, I want to do a story. Come on, you know, we'll come out there, we'll jump. And I said, just hold on. I wanted to come here first. So this is where I came after I became president first. Because this was the place that opened their doors up to a very disoriented Native American kid fresh off the res, the five-year-old kid in hand, no money. This is where I began everything. In our way, we don't forget where we started. If we did, we don't exist. So this place means a lot to me, if it does. And I'm not as much fascinated with the building structure and the land, but the people, you know, all the people that have gone through here. You are the most amazing future that this town has to offer right now. You're here from all of us. Whether you're differently abled, whether you're poor, whether they need help, whatever field you go into, you're going to do well. And I see myself sitting here as well, celebrating with you everything you've ever done, everything you ever will do, your parents, your grandparents, that are no longer here to see you. They're very proud of you. So with that, an object to you, which Jagu Ihega, only don't we will watch it. Next day, the Jagu Ihega, Ihega, Hatmune, only don't. Next day, an object to you. Inati Iwi, next day, only don't we will watch it. Thank you.
I actually like listening to Hmong too, but I don't understand it too well. It sounds good. It's just German that doesn't sound so good. That's the only one I speak besides English. Thank you very much. That's great. So we're also going to have two graduating students give talks. The first one, Alicia Nelson, is our non-traditional student, and she's majoring in biology. She graduated from Maryland. girl in high school. That's where Chips is, isn't it? Okay, I just want to make sure. Just to find that out. She marries her family, works as a dental assistant, and as she says, she loves teeth. She's got a lot of them, in case you're wondering. She is in one of my classes in social. I should tell her the thing about myself. I gave her, I recorded it in 91, and then she showed me the exam and it said 94. I tried my best. She's really terrific. The one thing I find her, she smiles all the time. There are a couple of people like that around. And I do what I can because my background is German and we have to be serious. Okay, and now she plans to pursue a bachelor's degree in biology and one day be a dentist.
Time to meet, and
And in a matter of minutes, he had changed my whole last semester. I went from pure math and science courses to more psychology, sociology, and philosophy. It was a huge brain changer, but all the credits that transfer with me to NTC, which is where I'll be receiving my dental hygiene associate's degree. These classes also fulfilled my requirements so that I could stand in front of y'all today and graduate. I wouldn't be here today without the support of my family, the guidance of TRIO, and the help of my professors. UWMC has great staff, knowledgeable in their areas, and full of encouraging wisdom. I'd like to personally thank Jason Siegel, who in my first semester taught me to think critically, and Claire Hemingway, who taught me there's lies, damn lies, and then there's statistics, which makes use of my critical thinking. Professor Amundsen, thank you for sharing your inspiring journey to receiving your doctorate, which continues to remind me that anything is possible with enough self-efficacy. To Penny Workman, who taught me that if you don't do your homework, you'll be in all kinds of trouble on this day. Finally, thank you, Terry Dunring. You not only taught me how to prepare and deliver a speech, but you gave me and the rest of our class the courage to have a voice. For everyone graduating today, don't be afraid of changing your plans. Embrace it. Every spring buds open from prosperous trees. Throughout the beautiful summer days, sunny days of summer, without planning, trees produce vast amounts of chlorophyll that keep the leaves green and enables them to soak up the sun's resources. As fall creeps in, chlorophyll production slows, and the leaves change to vibrant yellows and oranges and reds that we all enjoy before falling to the ground. The tree doesn't worry about changing leaves because it plans to prosper again next summer. Congratulations, class of 2019. Embrace the change and prosper.
Our next student speaker is the recipient of the campus's highest academic award, the Samuel Weiner Award. It's Lucas Hintz. After starting at NTC, he came to Marathon County, where, let me read these, he says, one professor after another blew his mind and caged his curiosity and unlocked opportunity. Obviously, he didn't have me. Which is true. He served as campus ambassador and is going to be transitioning to the main campus at the UW students went to fall on his way to medical school. Will you please welcome Lucas Hintz.
Education we receive here at Wausau may sometimes be underestimated, But the legacy left for us by the CAD students is undeniable, as we have with her, awesome keynote speaker. The quality of our education has been proven time and time again. The best faculty here are not the easy ones. Not the ones that go easy on you, but they are the teachers who encourage attention to the smallest details, the ones who never quite give you that 100 on the exam. But it is these challenges that make our education so enduring and valuable, and it is the difficult times in our lives that often form the most enduring parts of our character. While the support of the school has been phenomenal, it pales in comparison with the army of people that I have in my corner. I have 12 siblings, so we really are an army. To my parents, Brandy and Karen, I want to say a very heartfelt thanks. Thank you for teaching me the value of love, respect, and stability. It has been said that you should surround yourself with the people that you want to be like. But I didn't even have to begin looking for the role models. My family is made up of a melting pot of cultures, spanning the globe, and you help me understand the true value of diverse ideas and opinions. And it is our differences that keep us together and make us strong and resilient. Although my sister, Julie, is pretty strong, just all by herself. I've been so privileged early in my life to have the opportunity to help care for people in their darkest times. As an EMT for a local ambulance service, I've tried to find the words to say when one of my patients asked me to let him die. While working at the local hospital, I've helped babies smaller than my hand, and seen young and old on their deathbed. It's true that I've found valuable insight in my time here at Wausau, but the perspective gained from seeing the very extremes of living and dying isn't one that's found in the classroom. Each and every one of us has been given a limited amount of time in this life, and while this might cause some to wonder if life isn't just futile, we should remember that valuable things always come in short supply. If I can give any advice at all to my fellow students, it is this. Spend some of your life in the service of others. Never shy away from uncomfortable situations. Lift others up when they have nothing left to give you in return. Always assume that they know something you do not. Their stories are often surprising. Their halted dreams more motivating than any speech. The lasting joy that you find in self-denial will be disproportionately greater than the effort you put in, and it will change your life. This evening marks one last collective hurrah for our students. The classrooms are empty, the halls are quiet, the discount cappuccinos in the student unit are almost sold out. Somewhere a fresh patch of academic ground is waiting for us, just begging for us to dig ourselves into another hole of procrastination. As we go our separate ways, let's continue to challenge ourselves with the ideas of the people around us. As we lead the way into the future, let's continue this school's tradition of high academic excellence. I'll leave you with one of my all-time favorite quotes, one that I have subsequently proven to myself over and over again in the last few years. It was the American author and speaker T. Harv Eker who once wrote, "If you are willing to do only what's easy, life will be hard. But if you are willing to do what's hard, life will be easy." Now, so thanks to everyone for coming out tonight and supporting us. It was my absolute honor to be able to speak to you today. Go Huskies. God bless you. Thank you very much.
Basically, dean of both Marshall and Wausau. And she has stories. She works with Anne, and she
assistant professor, and associate degree coordinator. He'll read the names of each participating student.
Thank you.
have received a lot of wonderful advice and wonderful humor, and it has truly been an honor to be a part of this ceremony tonight. But if you will indulge me, I have two last pieces of advice for you. My mother only gave me two pieces of advice in life. She said, be sure you can support yourself and keep your options open. I think all of you are well on your way to taking both pieces of advice after the preparation you've received to graduate today. But if I could provide some additions, be sure you can support yourself not just with the things you must do, but with things you can do and things you love to do. Keep your options open with the strength you need to persist to your goals, vulnerability to remain open to possibility even at your darkest hour, and openness to continually appreciate all the world around you. Congratulations, graduates. Now I ask all participating students to rise so I may confer the degree. By the authority vested in me by the Board of Regents of the University of Wisconsin System and the Chancellor of UW-Stevens Point, and upon recommendation of the faculty of this university, I confer upon you the associate's degree with all the honors and privileges that pertain thereto. Congratulations.
Thank you very much for joining us.